يلا خلاص بسم الله. الله المستعان. إن من شر البلية من ضحك والله. بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومواله. Indeed, all praises to Allah and my peace and blessings be upon His Messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Today is the 27th of Dhul Qa'dah 1445, synchronizing with the 4th of June 2024, and we are onto the same topic that we've been discussing for the last 15 weeks. How should we face the fitan? And we're coming now to the cream of the crop of the whole thing. We talked about the fitan, the type of it, and how the reason for that on all of this. We're going to talk about now al-manhaj, the methodology through which we're going to be dealing with this fitan. What is the manhaj? What does the Quran and the Sunnah say about dealing with those fitan? What does and how do the companions face this fitan? This is our topic. This is what we're going to be doing for the next weeks. And also, we will be discussing the scholars' understand regarding this fitan and the shubuhat, those things which are doubtful matters being thrown onto us, the people of the Sunnah wal Jama'ah, regarding those fitan, how to tackle them and how to deal with them. As I said, before, there was just usul, foundation, ta'sis. Now we're going to build upon this foundation. What did we learn from this? How to tackle the fitan. When you want to write, you to be correct in dealing with the fitna, then this cannot be achieved except by three things. At-tathabbutu, wa-thabatu, wa-sabru. Three things. Tathabbut, to make sure that it is a fitna. Because you cannot just see something happening and then you implement this is the fitna that the Prophet ﷺ talked about. It's called tathabbut. Al-thabat, that means you have to be affirm on the manhaj al-haq, on the Quran and the sunnah and how the salaf. It's called al-thabat. Can I ask for Ali, please, to switch off his microphone? Jazakallah khair. I've got a bug in this thing here. Every time I'm muting everybody, it's just somebody is able to do it. Ali, please, can you mute yourself? Third one, patience. How to be patient during these fitna? Because it's, with no patience, you'll never be successful. So let's just now deal with them one after the other. First, al-thabat, tathabbut, to know that this is the fitna. Because you have to be sure, is this the fitna that the Prophet ﷺ talked about? Or just one of the small fitnas? And how do we make sure that this is the correct one? We make sure that this is the correct one is by asking the scholars. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He had warned us to do something which is without knowledge. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا. So do not say something that you have no knowledge of. For verily, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ. All of those things that you are, your sight, your hearing, and whatever you comprehend and understand, you're going to be responsible for that and you're going to be liable for that. So make sure you don't fall into the fitna by not asking those scholars, is this a fitna or not? Allah Azza wa Jalla spoke about this in Surah An-Nisa. وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ, when it comes to them, Jazakallah khair, a matter, in al-amni aw al-khawf, whether it's safety, security, something, safety or something which is the fear, أَذَاعُوا بِهِ, they will say it. وَلَوْ رَدُّ, and the أَدَاعُوا بِهِ, because they are not good. They're not good people. وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ, إلى الرسول وإلى الأمر وإلى أولي الأمر منهم. And if they to send it back or to ask the messenger or those who are the people in charge, the ones who are scholars, the ones who are in charge in terms of leadership as well, لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ. Those the ones who are knowledgeable, they will know how to extract the knowledge out of those things. So when you hear something, is it fitna or not, I go to the scholars. I don't just go and go into it and talk about it without having verification. It's called تثبت. And those verification has to be through the scholars. And that is number one from that. Also, I'm going to ask, please, Ali, I'm going to remove you if you don't really mute yourself, أخي. You have to mute yourself. And also, I could make sure that I am going to be making sure that this is the fitna. And also, I will not release my tongue into it. So I need to make sure that I don't speak into it because I don't know. So if I don't know, be quiet. And you quiet, you're safe. كونوا أحلاس بيوتكم. Be like the doormat of your house. Don't leave. I mean, don't leave your house. I mean, don't indulge into something which is to do with the عامة. عليك بخاصتك. Be responsible of your people, your family. Why do you want to talk about something which you have no knowledge of? Why you want to say that this fitna, this is the Prophet ﷺ he talked about? So the Prophet ﷺ, when he had this person called Sufyan ibn Abdullah al-Thaqafi, came to him, messenger of Allah. حدثني بأمر أعتصم به. Tell me something that I hold on to it in the time of the fitan. قل ربي الله ثم استقم. He said to him, say my Lord is Allah, then steadfast to the straight path. Messenger of Allah, what is the most thing that you fear upon me? He said, كف عليك هذا. Keep that in check. عليك بلسانك. This is the one. Most of the sins of the ummah, as the Prophet he said, where from? From the tongue. أكثر المعاصي. Most of the sins that comes from the people of the Islam are because of the harvest of their tongue. عقبة بن عامر الجهني رضي الله عنه. When he asked the Prophet ﷺ, what is salvation, messenger of Allah? So he said to him, salvation, number one, number two, and then he asked the last thing, he said, قال أملك عليك لسانك. Keep that in check. This one. وليسعك بيتك ولتبكي على خطيئتك. And keep to your house and weep over your sin. That means you don't have to go indulge into the fitna and talk about it. And we know that the fitna in the bilad, in the Muslim countries, they were a result and consequences of those people who keep talking about it. They have no knowledge whatsoever, and they start talking about it, especially the ones who are from the Hizbiyin, the partisans and all of that. They escalate the matter with no knowledge. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إن أخوف ما أخاف على أمتي. The most thing that I fear upon my ummah, منافق عليم اللسان. A hypocrite whose tongue, you know, he is like a chatterbox. Speaks and people listen to him. This is a munafiq, hypocrite. So we want to make sure that we stop our tongue. And this is the first matter. So number one, التثبت, to make sure that this is a fitna. How? By referring to the scholars. Or number two, be quiet. Second issue in the fitan, that is al-thabat, to be affirmed upon the deen, upon the correct methodology. So when the person, he knows that this is the fitna, then he would make sure that he will be upon the deen. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. From the people who worship Allah upon an edge. فَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةً. If is to be struck. So فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ. If good goes on to him, he will be relaxed and he will be subtle into it. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ إِنْقَلَبَ عَلَى وَجْهِهِ خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةَ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ مُبِينٌ. That if a calamity befalls him, something has happened to him, straight away he will leave the religion because he's not being firming his foot into the deen. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ. From the people who say, I believe in Allah. فَإِذَا أُوذِيَ فِي اللَّهِ جَعَلَ فِتْنَةَ النَّاسِ كَعْذَابِ اللَّهِ. If he's to be harmed in the sake of Allah, he will make the harm that he received from the people like the punishment from Allah Azza wa Jal. They're not the same. So once you are established, this is a fitna because the scholars told you, be quiet. Ask the scholars and be quiet. Now, hold on to your deen. It's very important. So when the fitna goes into the people, people are of one, which is falls into it. Another, he's not falling into it, but he comes out, but he's scratched. The fitna had affected him somehow. There's something into him. Today I was asking about one of the students of knowledge. And he mentioned his name. I said, how is he? He said, wallah, he's stuck with the fitna. Fitna. One of the very good brothers of the Salafi, mashallah, stuck with the fitna. You don't want to be in the fitna, do you? As soon as you see the fitna somewhere, keep away from it. Keep yourself, you're safe. We don't know what's going to happen to you. You don't know. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had also told us to do the dua after each salah, when you do the salah. So, وَنَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ فِتْنَةِ الْمَحْيَا وَالْمَمَاتِ. We seek refuge in you, O Lord, from the fitna of the living life and the fitna at the time of death, when you die. وَمِنْ فِتْنَةِ الْمَحْيَا وَالْمَمَاتِ وَمِنْ شَرِّ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. And this is the fitna which is the biggest one. You don't want to be alive when Dajjal comes in. But if he came and you are alive, you need to be equipped with the right way of tackling this fitna. So if you heard about the Dajjal, ya Sheikh Rida, if you heard about the Dajjal, what do you do? That's the first thing. He came and he came to Brixton. Huh? So you move away from Brixton. Take a ticket and go to the furthest. Where do you go? The best thing, Medina or Mecca, or both of them. So all these pieces, or Masjid Al-Aqsa. Mecca and Medina, all of it secure. So I will not go say, I'm going to show the Dajjal what I am, because I am really equipped with the deen. I'm very strong now. You go there and it gives you fitna, that's it, you're finished. So this is what you do. For you seek refuge in Allah to hold on to the religion from this fitan. In every prayer, you say, اللهم إني أعوذك من عذاب القبر ومن عذاب جهنم ومن فتنة المحيا والممات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال ومن المأثم والمغرم. Those five things you seek refuge in Allah in the prayer every time you finish your prayer, especially in the second tashahud. First tashahud is not compulsory, but in the second tashahud is compulsory to seek refuge from those four. I'm adding to them hadith which is fifth, ومن المأثم والمغرم. مأثم goes to the sin, مغرم to be in debt. Third, we said, ثَبَاتُ وَتَثَبَّتُ وَالصَّبْرُ, to be affirmed that this is a fitna, and then to be affirmed in the deen when the fitna comes in. The third one, to be patient. See, when the fitna goes onto you, you have fallen into the fitna, okay, and you are affirmed to the religion, with this affirmed, you have to be as well patient, and hope for the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is going to test you. وَنَلَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. We're going to test you with the following. Fear, hunger, money going to decrease. And also the people who you love with, they will die. And also your crops, your property, you might lose them. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. And give glad tidings to whom? The ones who are patient. الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. The ones, if they are struck with a calamity, قَالُوا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. They would say, we're going to go to Allah, to him, and to him we shall return. So we belong to Allah, and also we're going to return to him. Those are the ones who are going to be successful. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Those are the ones who are going to have the mercy from your Lord, and those are the ones who are going to be guided. So patience is a weapon for the believer, which by which he will save himself and protects himself from the fitna. Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, I've heard the Prophet saying, because he lived, Anas, for a long time, he had seen the time of Al-Hajjaj. So he said to them, Isbiru. Prophet said, be patient. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ زَمَانٌ إِلَّا وَالَّذِي بَعْدَهُ شَرٌّ مِّنْ حَتَّى تَلْقَوْ رَبَّكُمْ. There's not a single time will come to you except the one after will be what? Worse. So in general, the one who's going to come after is going to be worse. So the ones who are before us, better than us in general. حَتَّى تَلْقَوْ رَبَّكُمْ, until you meet your Lord. Of course there is, you could say, things that, what do you call them, like some points with an exception, like Al-Mahdi is going to come, Dajjal is going to come after as well, Dajjal is going to come, and then Mahdi عليه السلام, Isa is going to come after that. So there's exceptions here. And as the scholars, they said, لابد للناس متنفس. People has to have something to breathe. You cannot just say, what am I living for? Every year is going to be the following year is going to be worse. People will be in despair. But in general, so look, who is before Hajjaj or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz al-Khalifa? Which one is first? Come on, guys. Who's first? Hajjaj? Al-Hajjaj. Hajjaj was worse, wasn't he? Killer. At the time, Umar ibn Aziz, what was that? Best of times. Look, Hajjaj. So if we implement this hadith, hang on. So the Hajjaj is worse. After that came Umar ibn Aziz, which is much, much better. It doesn't signal with the hadith. Every year, the following year will be worse. How the scholars tackle this issue? By two things. Number one, they're saying that it is not all the time like this. It's the general trend. Number two, which is even a better interpretation, that the time of the Hajjaj, yes, he's a bad leader, but in general, the whole time, much better than the time of Umar al-Aziz, where there were more deviants, more partisans. At the time of the Hajjaj, they didn't have those people who are extreme into the bid'ah. At Umar al-Aziz, they were emerged already. So in terms of Khilafah, it was the best of Khilafah. But in terms of the time and the scholars, the time of the Hajjaj, we had Sahaba. So can you tell me the time after Sahaba is after better than the Sahaba? No. Sayyid Anas radiallahu anhu, Sahaba was living at that time. Sayyidun Jubayr, great Imam. So the followers of the time and the followers are better than the followers of the followers in general. So we say that the person be patient. Now we're coming to the sayings and the stances of the Salaf, the companions, the Salaf, and also the ones who are after the companions. How did they deal with the fitan? What was their sayings and how did they took their stance regarding those fitan? We start with Udaysah ibn Uhban. Uhban is his kunya Abu Muslim. And Abu Muslim is a companion. Udaysah, she's his daughter. She said, when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu came to Basra to meet her father, and that is Abu Muslim, and Basra where Aisha radiallahu anha, along with Zubair, along with Talha, they came with lots of people with them in order to take the retaliation from the killers of Uthman. So Aisha, when she was called with them, this is called Waqatul Jamal. Before I start talking about Waqatul Jamal, I would like please to understand, when you talk about those incidents that happened between the companions, and the companions when they differed with each other, we have to have the following criterion or rule. Number one, that they are making ijtihad, because they're human beings. Number two, we always speak about them in the high, the best. Number three, to keep our tongue away from saying anything wrong about them. Number four, Allah had forgiven them. Already giving them a check, it's been forgiven. So they've been forgiven, the companions. So all these have to be kept in your mind. Whether who had said against the other, like when the incident took place between Ali radiallahu anhu and Aisha, or between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah. Okay, we have to be very importantly speaking about those companions high, and not to indulge our tongue badly upon them, and that they made ijtihad. And they are each ijtihad ma'jur. Because he made ijtihad not from whims and desire. He thought that this is the correct opinion. And fourthly, that they are being forgiven. What happened is when the fitna started is when Uthman radiallahu anhu killed. And the Prophet ﷺ told us about this fitna. He said to the companions, Inni ara, I can see, when he was on top of a hill and he looked, قال مواقع الفتن كواقع المطر. I could see it. You see, he dropped the rain, he could see it amongst the houses. He said, I could see the fitna goes in between the houses. After he could see that, this is the fitnah that's going to come to the Medina. Now, did they start in the Medina or started somewhere else? Again, the scholars are different. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alhamdulillah, he had said, Allahumma barik lana fi madinatina, Allahumma barik fi sa'ina, Allahumma barik, so he, fi al-mikyal, wa sa'a. Prophet Allah had made barakah, which is mikyal of Mecca, sa' of the Medina, wa muddina, wa shamina, may Allah barak and sham. When he was, wa iraqina, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went quiet. Messenger, wa iraqina. He said, from there comes the fitan wa zalazil. Fitan, zalazil means earthquake, but earthquake here, earthquakes for the religion. Earthquakes. Fitan wa zalazil. And one day as well, the Prophet of Allah was in his pulpit, he was pointing to the east. And he said, from there, qarnu shaitan will come out. So if we look at the fitan, started in the Medina, which is killing of Uthman, but who the one killed the Medina? Uthman. From there, coming from that side. So he pointed to the east, and the east is towards Iraq from the Medina. There's another race, he said, Nahwa Bayti Aisha. He had pointed towards the house of Aisha. Now, Nahu is different from Ila. Nahu, like we said, like for example, where do you live? He said, well, towards the masjid. But I'm not living in the masjid. I mean, it could be behind the masjid, it could be before the masjid, but not in the masjid. Towards the masjid. Okay. So he did not point to Aisha's house because these, I call them idiots, Rafida. They say, well, Bayt Aisha, she's Bayt al-Qarn al-Shaytan. So I'm asking the question, that means the Prophet of Allah is living in Qarn al-Shaytan, akhi? What are you talking about? So he's saying Qarn al-Shaytan, and after he descends the pulpit, he's going to go to Qarn al-Shaytan and sleep in Qarn al-Shaytan? Al-Musta'an. Oh, these people, they don't really make their brain work. So the hadith says, towards the east. Another hadith says, Najd. Najd, the Akhwani, is not Najd of the Arabian Peninsula. Najd means Iraq. Because the hadith would mention Iraq, not the Najd. Because these people, they say, Muhammad Wahhab, Najdi, Najdi, means Qarn al-Shaytan. See these, the Sufis. As for the Rafida, towards Aisha, Aisha al-Shaytan. SubhanAllah. They don't understand the hadith. Prophet of Allah had explained it, that is towards Iraq. طيب. When Uthman was killed, and this is the first fitna took place after the lock of the gate was killed, and that is Umar al-Khattab. Umar al-Khattab, when he was killed, now the gate is open, awaiting for the first fitna to take place. And that was Uthman. After Uthman, companions now had amongst them a split of opinions. Some of them, they said, we want to have those people summoned for, you know, their crime. Some of them, they went quiet. Some of them, they said, we will do that, but not now when we are stronger. Can I ask anybody to tell me? And some of them even did not give the pledge to Ali, the Khalifa, unless he's going to have what? A retaliation. Out of these four groups, some of them, okay, said, I'm not going to give the pledge, okay, to Ali until he bring those people to justice, the one who killed Uthman. Some of them, they said, they gave the bay'ah, but they're asking Ali to do it straight away. Some of them, they said, well, we will get that, but not now when we are stronger. Some of them, they went quiet and kept away from the fitna. Okay? Now, I'm going to tell you who are the leaders of each group. First one, which is the one that did not give the pledge until the retaliation takes place, that's Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Second group, which is the one, gave the pledge, but they said, we have to straight away get those people to justice. And that is Talha, Zubair, and Aisha radiallahu anhu, and the one who are with them. Some of them, they said, no, we will do it, but after we get strong. And that's Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. Some of them, they kept away from the fitna. I'm asking anybody to tell me, which one is the biggest group of all of those? Which one? Is it the one? We're not going to give the pledge until you bring them. Or the one, we'll give you the pledge, but you have to do it and bring these people to justice. Or the ones, followers of Ali, that we will do it, but when we get stronger. Or the one who kept away from the fitna. Last one. Do you know what is the ratio? The last one is 99.99%. Do you understand that? Last one, the one who does not want the fitna, most of the companions. Because it's a brother against what? A brother. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she was convinced by Talha and Zubair to go to Basra, not to go to Medina. Medina, Ali is in Medina. She's not making a coup. To go to Basra, so the people come to, all together, so that we will have strong to go and get those people to justice. Muawiyah ibn al-Sham, he did not give the pledge until the retaliation takes place. That's why later on there will be another battle, which is Battle Safin after that. So those who had kept away from the fitna, those are the one upon the haqq. So here I'm going to this hadith. Udaysa bint Uhban. Udaysa, she said, my daughter, the daughter of Uhban, which is Abu Muslim, Muslim's companion, that Ali radiallahu anhu, when he was the caliph, he came to her father. And he said, Ala tu'inuni ala ha'ulai al-qawm. Are you going to help me regarding those people? Those people he meant, that is Talha, Zubair, and the ones who were with them. They had an army with them, big one. Are you going to help me, you know, towards these people? So he said, Bala, yes. Caliph, yes. Go on. He asked for his little girl to go and get his sword. She went to get his sword. And then when he pulled it up just slowly, it's wood. It's not even metal. So he pulled it slowly, it's wood. So he said to him, what is this? He said, verily, inna khalili. Khalil me, my close friend. And he is your cousin. Who's that? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Said to me, when there is a fitna between the Muslims, take a sword from wood. So if you wish, I'll go out with you. But my wood didn't sort. My wood isn't going to kill anyway. If you wish, I'll come with you. He said, we don't need you, nor we need your sword. We don't need you, nor we need your sword. So that's the first issue regarding taking a sword. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, in the days of fitan, kassiru qisiyakum. Your iron bows and your spear, break them. Come to your sword and break it into the stone. Make it. Don't take the sword. Because you're going to kill your brother. Subhanallah. Abdullah ibn Samit. He says, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu came to Uthman from Bilad al-Sham. Abu Dharr came to Uthman in Medina from Bilad al-Sham. Uthman is the caliph. So he said to him, Ya Amir al-Mumin, O leader of the believers, Iftah al-Bab hatta yadkhul an-nas. Open the door so the people come in. Do you believe, do you think that I am from those people who recite the Quran and will not go beyond their collar bone? What is that? Khawarij. So Abu Dharr said, don't be afraid, Uthman. Open the door. Do you think I am from those people who recite the Quran, but their Quran will not go beyond their collarbones, not down to affect their hearts, not up to be rewarded? Those are the ones who will pass through the religion like the arrow passes through the game. You remember the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ? You know that these people will pass through the deen like the arrow passes the game. Then when you look at these arrows, you can't find any, no blood, nothing, not even on the feathers of the arrow. There's nothing there. I mean, these people went to the religion, came out, no deen in their heart, nothing. قال, هم شر الخلق والخليقة, the worst of the creation. والذي نفسي بيده. Abu Dharr, he said, by the one whose hand is my soul. لو أمرتني أن أقعد لما قمت. If you command me to sit, I will never stand up. Look. This is called full obedience to the ones of Egypt. If you have commanded me to sit, I will never stand. ولو أمرتي أن أكون قائما لقمت ما أمكنتني رجلي. And if you told me to stand up, commanded me, I will stand up as much as my leg can hold me. I'm going to get tired. But I will stand up as much. It means I'm going to be full responsive to your commands. I will not make a coup against you. I will not disobey you. ولو ربطتني على بعير لم أطلق نفسي حتى تكون أنت الذي تطلقني. And if you tie me upon a camel, I will not untie myself until you, خليفة, come and untie me or command someone to untie me. Then he took permission from Uthman to come to a place called Al-Rabada. So he gave him permission and he went to Al-Rabada. And there was a slave and he was about to lead his people in the prayer. So when he's about to lead, they have said, Abu Dharr, Abu Dharr, the companion came. So this slave went backwards to let Abu Dharr to lead. So he said to him, come forward to lead. So he said to him, Abu Dharr, Awsani Khalili, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, my close companion, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had given me three recommendations. Three things, he prompted me with three things. He prompted me with three things. Number one, an asma'a wa ati'a. And that is, an asma'a wa ati'a, and to hear and obey. Walau li'abdin habashiyin mujadda'il atraf. Even to a slave who is not having his limbs in full. He's got his hands cut off, his ears cut off, his nose is not there, his legs is not there. Mujadda'il atraf. Hands and legs are not there. I will hear and obey. Now we're going to come even to a better clear hadith from Abu Dharr himself of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he said, the Prophet of Allah came to me while I was sleeping in the masjid. So he kicked me with his foot. Ala araka na'iman fi. Why do I see you sleeping in the masjid? Said Messenger of Allah, well, I overslept. My eyes just overcome me and I slept. Said, فَكَيْفَ تَصْنَعُ إِذَا أُخْرِجْتَ مِنْ What are you going to do if you're being expelled from the masjid? Taken out by force. What are you going to do? He said, well, مَا أَصْنَعُ يَا نَبِيَ اللَّهِ أَضْرِبُ بِسَيْفِ What I'm going to do, of course. I'm going to do what? I'm going to start fighting with my sword. How can somebody drive me away from the masjid? I'm going to fight with my sword. So the Prophet he said, أَلَا أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى مَا هُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ Shall I tell you something which is better than what you're saying? وَأَقْرَبُ رُشْدًا And also it is much more common sense than what you just said. تَسْمَعُ وَتُطِيعُ To hear and obey them is come out of the masjid. تَسْمَعُ وَتُطِيعُ وَتَنْسَاقُ لَهُمْ حَيْثُ سَقُوكُ And you go with them wherever they take you. That's why Abu Dharr, he said to that, to Uthman radiallahu anhu. If you tell me to stand up, I'll stand up. If you sit down, I'll sit down. Whatever you say, I will do it. I'm not going to go like these khawarij. They became the coup. Because of what the Prophet ﷺ told Abu Dharr, Awsani Khalili, Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu. Hudhayfa, it was said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, which is his kunya, Ma ta'muruna idha qtatala al-musallun. What do you command us to do if the people who are in the masjid, the ones who pray, started to fight one another? He said, well, I command you to look at the farthest, the most farthest place in your house and stay there. Not in your house, in the corner, really far away corner, in your house and stay there. And if one of those people who are the musallin came to you, then say to him, ha bu'bi ithmi, take my sin. That means the sin of killing me. فَتَكُونَ كَبْنِي Adam, And then you'll be like the son of Adam. Habil. So Habil, what did he say? Well, go on. And if you're going to stretch your hand to kill me, مَا أَنَا بِبَاسَطِ يَدِيَ إِلَيْكَ لِأَقْتُلَ I'm not going to kill you. I'm not going to stretch my hand to kill you. I want you to go and take my sin and the sin of yours. تَبُوَ بِإِثْمِي وَإِثْمِكَ طيب. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he said, Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Umar, he is the one who known to follow the Prophet ﷺ in everything that he knows. To the latter. Abdullah ibn Umar, he's urinated underneath the tree where the Prophet of Allah urinated. Radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Umar, he is from those party, remember we've divided four categories? He's from the ones who did not go into the fitna. I'tazal al-fitna. Fitna, I'm not going to go into it. He was wrong when it was against he was wrong in the fitna in one of them the scholar they said he kept away from it because you see the fitna is you don't know the haq from the batil Muslim killing Muslim you don't know which one is correct but let's say that there's a leader and he's a Muslim and though some Muslims had gone against him Allah said فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَفْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ لِمَنِ اللَّهِ fight those who are transgressors until it goes back to Allah Azza wa Jal Otherwise, any cool person would make a coup and say, well, nobody's going to kill me because everybody's going to be castrating himself for the fitna. No. But we don't see the haqq properly. Like at the time of Ali, at the time of Zubayr and Talha, it's not clear why the fight is taking place. Shouldn't be a fight. They didn't come to fight. And by the way, in both sides is the one who had triggered the fight. From both sides, the side of Ali and the side of Talha and Zubayr, there were some people who said, if they're going to come together, they're going to come after us. So let's just make a split amongst them. That's what happened. Now, coming to Sa'id ibn Jubayr, saying, خرج علينا عبد الله ibn Umar. Abdullah ibn Umar came out onto us. So we hope that he will tell us a hadith, a nice hadith. So we came to him, and one of the men, he asked him, Ya Aba Abd al-Rahman, which is the kunya, the nickname of Abdullah ibn Umar. حدثنا عن القتال في الفتنة. Talk to us about fighting in the fitna, to fight in the time of the fitna. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَتَكُونَ فِتْنَةً, and fight them until there is no fitna. So he said to him, هَلْ تَدْرِي مَا الْفِتْنَةَ ثَكِلَتْكَ أُمُّكَ. Do you know what the fitna that Allah, he said, fight them until there is no fitna. Do you know what is the fitna? May your mother lose you? He was to teach him in the harsh way. For verily, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he used to fight the kuffar, the mushrikeen. And coming into their deen is a fitna. That means leaving Islam and becoming a kafir, that's a fitna. But not your fight for the sake of who is going to lead. That's one narration. There's another narration where a man came to him and he said, Ya Aba Abdul Rahman, can't you hear what Allah had said? وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا. Okay, when the two groups of the people, فَقَاتُوا الَّتِي تَغْرِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ الْأَمْرِ اللَّهِ, fight the one who transgresses. So why don't you fight just like what Allah told you in his book? It's regarding Battle of Siffin, Battle of Jamal. He said, يَبْنَ أَخِي, oh son of my brother. He's not his son or brother as in nephew, but this is how the person addresses the one who's younger than him. My nephew, my son or my brother. I would like to be defamed and called names because of this ayah and not to fight. So that means I did not fight, and somebody going to use this ayah against me because I did not fight is dear to me than that later on I will be called names because of the following ayah. وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. I don't want to be in that ayah. So the ayah says, fight them and there is no fitna. Okay, you're going to be calling me names because of that ayah? Why didn't you fight? Well, it's better for me to have this ayah, to be calling me with this ayah, rather than to be, when I fight and then I kill somebody, and Allah says, he who kills a believer deliberately, then his recompense is, he is going to have four things. Number one, that is what? Jahannam. Number two, he's going to be dwelled therein forever. Number three, غضب الله عليه, Allah's anger is upon. Number four, Allah curses him. Number five, and he prepared for him a severe punishment. I would rather have the first verse, not this one. So he said to him, but Allah says, وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَتَكُونَ فِتْنَةً, fight them until there is no fitna. He said, verily, my dear brother, we fought them at that time until there is no fitna, and the whole deen, وَيَكُونُ الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ لِلَّهِ, and the religion would become to Allah Azza wa Jalla, وَيَكُونُ الدِّينُ لِلَّهِ. So we fought them until there is no fitna, and we fought them until the religion is for Allah, but you want to fight until there is a fitna, and the deen will be to other than Allah. نعم قاتلناهم في عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى لا تكون فتنة ويكون الدين لله ولكنكم تريدون أن تقاتلون حتى تكون فتنة ويكون الدين لغير الله. And that's the words, the golden words of Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما. Mutarrif ibn Abdullah ibn Shikhir. Mutarrif is from the ear of the followers. His father's a companion, Abdullah ibn Shikhir. He's a great man, and he was one of the people who had proper knowledge regarding the fitna. He said, the fitna is not to come to guide the people. But the fitna, it comes to fight the believer for his religion. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, He would say, لِمَ قَتَلْتَ فُلَانًا? Why did you kill so-and-so? This would be, she said, it is better for me to have Allah saying to me, why didn't you kill so-and-so? Better for me than Allah is asking me, why did you kill so-and-so? Do you ask me? Do you understand what I'm saying? Allah is to ask me, why didn't you kill so-and-so? Because I didn't kill him. It would be better for me to be asked this question rather than Allah is asking me, if I kill someone, why did you kill so-and-so? See the difference? If Allah asked me, why didn't I kill that person? Well, I had some my reasons because it's a fitna. But if I killed him and I'm wrong, I will be in trouble. Also, he said the fitna comes and it does not come to guard the people, but actually to fight the person his religion. So be careful, ikhwan. When you're on the fitna, keep your tongue shut if you don't really understand and if you don't have the knowledge. Mutarrif, he said that I would say it's better for me to sit rather than to go and ask for the jihad, which I'm not sure about. He said, if Allah is going to ask me on the day of resurrection, oh Mutarrif, why did you do such and such? It would be better than to say to me, why did you do it? Why didn't you do such and such? Better than to say, why did you do it? Mutarrif, he said, in the time of Ibn al-Ash'ar, it's another fitna took place, and it was at the time of Hajjaj, people calling him to fight the Hajjaj. When they said, come on, do it. So he said, the thing that you're calling me to do, what is it? Isn't it just jihad fi sabilillah? They said, yeah. Is it going to be more than the jihad fi sabilillah? They said, no. He said, verily, I would be better not to put my deen in stake by going into something, maybe cannot be jihad, and maybe on something that I will get the reward of it. So if I go to jihad, I'm not sure, then I'm gambling here. It would be better for me to keep away from this because I'm not sure it's a jihad. So Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, he said, if the people at the time of fitna did not resort to the sword, Allah will give them the victory. But when they are in the fitna, straight away they pull the sword and kill one another as Muslims. So they don't really go to the sword, Allah will make them to have the sword as their guard, as their leader. We see that the people, as soon as they don't like something from the leader, they go to the killing and so on and so forth. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he said, enjoining good and forbidding evil is good, but it is not from the sunnah to raise your weapon against your leader. Suwayd ibn Ghafala, he said, Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he said to me that maybe you will stay behind and you live longer to see the fitan. So what you should do, isma' wa ata', hear and obey. Even is to be a Abyssinian slave, and even is to lash you, be patient. Even if it's to deprive you or wrong you, be patient. Even if he is to do anything, be patient. But if he asks you to do a sin, something to do with the religion, say to him, hear and obey, I hear and obey, but my blood comes before my deen. So leader, I hear and obey, but because you're asking me to sin against Allah, no. Here I come, I would say to you, my blood comes first than my what? Deen. My deen had to protect it. And that's the recommendation of Umar radiallahu an to Suwayd ibn Ghafala. طيب, this is how the scholars of the Salaf radiallahu anhum wa ardahum, they used to tackle the fitan and what their stance. I'll finish with Umar ibn al-Aziz rahimahullah. He said, if you have an imam which is doing Quran and Sunnah, implementing Quran and Sunnah, then fight along with your imam. But if you have an imam which he does not implement the Quran and the Sunnah, and there was a person who is making a coup against him, he's calling to the Quran and the Sunnah, sit down in your house, don't participate. Again, you had an imam, Muslim, but he does not implement the Quran and the Sunnah. He's a Muslim. And you had a person who was a Khawarij. He's fighting that leader. And he wants to implement the Quran and the Sunnah, sit in your house, don't participate. Do you know why? Because in participating would lead to bloodshed. And this is not the way to change. This is not the way to change. How do we get salvation from the fitan? So we are in a time now, as I said, number of times, in the fitna of, well, Palestine is a fitna, ikhwani. What is going in Gaza is a fitna. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يفرج عن إخواننا المسلمين في غزة وفي مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. والله our brothers there don't know what to do. Massacre after a massacre. Holocaust after Holocaust. والله. But this is a Holocaust which has been documented by the cameras. Everything is there. Nobody can doubt it. You could see people being killed. الله المستعان. طيب. First of all, with taqwa, we can really fight the fitna. Taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This taqwa is coupled with isma' wa ati', hear and obey. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the farewell advice, عليكم بتقوى الله والسمع والطاعة. This is the recommendation that the Prophet Allah gave us before he died. Hold on to the taqwa of Allah and hear and obey. Subhanallah. Hadith Al-Irbad ibn Sariya. All Salafi should be memorized in the hadith. Al-Irbad ibn Sariya. وَعَظَنَا رَسُولَ سَلَّمَ مَوْعِظَةً دَرَفَتْ مِنْهَا الدُّمُوعَ وَجَرَتْ مِنْهَا الْقُلُوبَ حَتَّى قَالَ قَائِلَ كَأَنَّهَا مَوْعِظَةٌ مُوَدِّعِيَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. You have to memorize the hadith. Because it's very important. What did he say that? Farewell advice. That عَلَيْكُمْ بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ. Hold on to taqwa Allah وَالسَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ. وَإِنْ تَوَلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ حَبَشِيٌّ رَأْسُهُ رَأْسُ زَبِيبٍ. Even if to be led by someone who is not supposed to lead, from Abyssinia, different race, different color, different language, but he led, you have to hear and obey. You cannot just, you know, ignore him. You have to hear and obey. وَلَوْ مُجَدَّعَ الْأَطْرَافِ. Even if to have his limbs being cut off, as we said. Also the Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَكُونُ بَعْدِي أَئِمَّةِ. After me, there will be leaders. لا يهتدون بهداي ولا يهتدون بسنتي. They were not going to be guiding to my guidance. No, they're going to be guiding to my sunnah, or they're abiding themselves with the sunnah of mine. And سيقوم فيهم رجال قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين. Amongst them, there will be people whom their hearts, they will be the hearts of devils. في جثماني اسم, إثنس, in the human being form. So the chassis, human being, but the inside, the machine is what? Shayateen. The chassis from outside, human being. But inside, shayateen. Can you have more or worse description than the description of the Prophet of Allah? People who are looking like human being, but they have hearts of the shayateen. I cannot really call any leader worse than that. Yet the Prophet gave the worst. You could just say anything you like, but you cannot come to the worst of description of the Prophet of Allah to one of those people. Yet, what did he say? When Hudhayfa, he said, ما أصنع؟ كيف تصنع؟ كيف أصنع يا رسول الله؟ What shall I do in أدركت ذلك? If I live to see this. My leader, human being, shaitan from inside. Can I be able to see the heart of any person? So the Prophet of Allah, he is saying that, let's say that for the sake of argument, he's 100% is telling me that his heart is shaitan. Because I can't determine these leaders about shaitan or not. I could see that action from outside shaitan. But I can't determine that they are shaitan from inside. But the Prophet of Allah is saying to you, let's say this, I'm telling you that their heart is shaitan. Because I'm from revelation, they are from shaitan. What should I do? Messenger of Allah, to see them. تسمع وتطيع للأمير. Hear and obey. وإن ضرب ظهرك وأخذ مالك. Even to lash you back and take your money. فاسمع وأطيع. Hear and obey, إخوانا. He repeated, فاسمع وأطيع, فاسمع وأطيع. And those people say, لا تسمع ولا تطيع. Those people say, لا تسمع ولا تطيع. لا تسمع ولا تطيع. It's exactly what the Prophet ﷺ said. وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة. And these people say, not every محدثة بدعة. Prophet of Allah, every khutbah saying, وكل محدثة بدعة. No. That's not, there's no بدعة. There's something which is called بدعة حسنة. لا حول ولا قوة. وكل بدعة ضلالة. وكل محدثة بدعة. يا أخي, he says, كل, every, and they say, not every. Prophet of Allah, اسمع وأطع, اسمع وأطع, اسمع. No, not اسمع وأطع. Here and obey. It's there in front of me. Hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. This hadith in Sahih Imam Muslim. Auf ibn Malik, he said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, خيار أئمتكم, the best of your leaders, الذين تحبونهم ويحبونكم. The ones you love them and they love you. ويصلون عليكم وصلون عليهم. And they pray upon your deceased, the one who dies, and you pray upon them when they die. وشرار أئمتكم, the worst of your imam, الذين تبغضونهم ويبغضونكم. The ones you hate them and they hate you. وتلعنونهم ويلعنونكم. And you curse them and they curse you. Messenger of Allah, what should we do regarding those? The ones what? We don't like them. We hate them. And they hate us. And the ones we are cursing them and we are cursing us. What should we do? قال, should we fight them? Should we get the sword and fight them? He said, no. لا. ما أقاموا فيكم الصلاة. As long as they let you to go and do the prayer. Whether in the masjid or inside the house. Never mind, you lock the masjid for something. In the house. Tell me which leader of the worst of the Muslim leaders he had prevented people to go to the masjid. Which? There's nothing, there's nobody there. ما أقاموا فيكم الصلاة. وإذا رأيتم من ولاتكم شيئا تكرهون. If you said from your leader, if you seen from your leader something which you don't like, you don't approve, فكره عمله. Hate what he does. ولا تنزعوا يدا من طاعة. But don't take your hand away from the pledge. يا أخي والله, clear instructions. Hate what he does. He gambles, you know, we have seen him gambling in such a... Hate what he does. Oh yes, he had... Whatever he does, you know, he's been such and such. His wife is not covered. Hate what he does. But don't pull your hand from the string. Hate it. And don't go to the pulpit. Oh, the king, such and such, I'm the king. What are you going to gain from that? Making people to hate him, and then a coup takes place. And then bloodshed. And then will be no safety and security. Second issue. So the first one, so how do we salvation from the fitan, is taqwallah wa sami wa ta'ah. Second one, that is you abide with the Muslims and their imams. If they have no imams, isolate yourself from all the partisans. Don't be the head of a fitna. This is the hadith of Hudhayfa again. اعتزل الفرقة كلها. If there's no imam, then there's no jama'ah. Keep away from all of them. Because the jama'ah has to have an imam. There's no such thing, jama'ah, no imam. That means they are like bandits. No. We follow the imam and their jama'ah. If there isn't, اعتزل الفرقة كلها ولو أن تعض على أصل شجرة حتى يدركك الموت وأنت على ذلك. Bite with your morals onto a tree, the root of a tree, until the death comes to you. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, there will be a fitan later on, gonna come. So the best of you is the one who is sitting. القاعد فيها خير من الماشي. The one who sits better than the one who is walking. والماشي فيها خير من الساعي إليها. And the one who is walking is better than the one who is running towards it. فإذا نزلت أو وقعت, if this fitna takes place, فمن كان له إبل فليلحق بإبله. If you got some camels, go to herd your camels. If you got some sheep, go and herd your sheep. And if you got land, go and plant your land. Plow it. Keep away from the fitna. So the second one we said, the first one we said, taqwallah wa sam'i wa ta'a. Second one, to abide yourself with the jama'ah of the imam. Third one is ibadah, ikhwani. Ibadatun fil harj, hijratun ilayh. If you made ibadah in the time of the fitan, the time of killing, it's like you're making immigration to the Prophet ﷺ. Ibadatun fil harj, hijratun ilayh. So make ibadah, ikhwani. Salama radiallahu anha, the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, he said the Prophet ﷺ woke up one day and he was terrified. And he said, Subhanallah, ماذا أنزل الله من الخزائن? What did Allah send down from the treasures? ماذا أنزل من الفتن? What Allah sent down from the fitan? He said, ماذا أنزل الله من الخزائن? خزائن is good things, treasures. And the other one, وماذا أنزل من الفتن? What sort of fitan had sent down? من يوقظ صواحب الحجرات? Who's going to wake up the ones who are the owners of the dwellers of these houses? He means his wives. لِكَيْ يُصَلِّينَ, so they could pray the prayer late night. رُبَّكَ سِيَّةٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا عَارِيَةٌ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. A woman, she is in this dunya, which is having her dress on, but on the hereafter, she's going to be naked. مَنْ يُوقِذُ صَوَاحِبَ الْحُجُرَاتِ. So Prophet of Allah is telling his wives to wake up. This is the time when the khaza'in, treasures, comes in. And this, by that time, by that ibadah, you are safe from the fitan. Fourth thing is to keep to your house. إلزم بيتك وليسعك بيتك وابكي على خطيئتك. hold your tongue and weep over your sin. This is what Uqba ibn Amir, when the Prophet said to him, قال أمسك عليك لسانك وليسعك بيتك وابكي على خطيئتك. So hold your tongue, keep it in check, also weep over your sins, and also keep your house. Don't go. كونوا أحلاسا بيوتكم, like the doormat of your house. حذيفة بن اليمان, he said, إياكم والفتن. Oh, be aware of the fitan. For any person who sticks his neck to say it, that fitan will get and stick its neck to get you. Be careful. There's a fitna, keep away. Don't just, you know, be nosy to go put your nose into it and then the fitna will get you. Fifth thing, of course, you seek Allah's help by seeking refuge from the fitan. تعوذوا بالله من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. Seek refuge in Allah from the fitna, whether the outward or the inward. علمنا رسول الله, Prophet Allah taught us to make isti'adha in the salah, that if you are to make tashahud, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min adhabi jahannam, min adhabi al-qabr, wa min fitnat al-mahya wal-mamat, min sharri fitnat al-masih al-dajjal, and I added wal-mamathami wal-maghram. So also make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you to steadfast onto your deen when the fitan takes place. وَنَجِّنَا بِرَحْمَتِكَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ رَبَّنَا عَلَيْكَ تَوَكَّلْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ أَنَبْنَا وَإِلَيْكَ الْمَصِيرُ رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَاغْفِرْ لَنَا رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. All these ayat to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep away from the fitan. And the Prophet really said, إِنَّ السَّعِيدَ لَمَنْ جُنِّبَ الْفِتَنَ. The happy man is the one who is keeping away from the fitna. إِنَّ السَّعِيدَ لَمَنْ جُنِّبَ الْفِتَنَ. Three times he said it. وَلَمْ يُتُولِيَ فَصَبَرَ فَوَهَا. But if the one is struck with the fitna and he was patient, then alhamdulillah, he's good as well. إخواني, we say in Arabic, إِذَا كَانَ الْكَلَامُ مِنْ فِضَّةِ فَالسُّكُوتُ مِنْ ذَهَبِ. If your speech is from silver, then your quietness is from gold. And this is why you say it in Arabic. I don't know if you say it in English, it's a parable or not. But it's better to not to speak in the time of the fitna. To be quiet. Allah created for you one mouth and two ears. So mathematically speaking, you should be listening twice to what you say. But some people, they speak about 10 times what they hear. They don't hear, they don't listen. So your ears, both, that means double what you speak. But some people, they don't stop. So be careful, ikhwani, to indulge yourself into fitna. If you don't say anything, better for you. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. By this, alhamdulillah, we finished what we have planned to talk about. Insha'Allah, next time we'll be talking about those scholars who are the inheritors of the prophets. Those are the ones who are dua. And we need to make sure that we're not going to be like those people who are hizbis. They will differentiate between the dua. He's a scholar, but he's not a da'iyah. SubhanAllah, masha'Allah, tabarakAllah. He's a scholar, but he's not a da'iyah. I mean, the da'i is better. The scholar is just like a whale. You need to put a bucket to fish. Where's the da'i? It goes like a cloud and rain. Rain what? Ignorance? These are the hizbi, they say like this. They always make the people to keep away from the knowledgeable people. And they're succeeding. Look at the clicks. Somebody who's a da'i, it's not a da'i, jahil. How many clicks on his videos? And look at the scholars. How many clicks on them? Maximum you can get maybe. After 20 years, maybe after 10 years, you might find 100,000. But in 3 hours to have 100,000, only Ahlul Bid'ah. True or not? 2 hours, 3 hours, 600,000. Wallah, one of them, because he's an entertainer. I'm not going to say his name because you might go and look for him. He's an entertainer. And he just explained things in the deen. He said, I revised it yesterday. MashaAllah. He revised something yesterday and he's telling us. This is knowledge. I was reading about it yesterday. So he just made his knowledge that people of knowledge takes years to get it. He just revised it, you know, last night or 2 days, you know, 2 days ago, and he's and the people listening to him. Why? Because he's got nice way of editing and all of that and showing the camera and the coming and, you know, things that scholars can't do. You know, scholars can't just dance like him or do things he does, and the camera goes like this. Imagine Sheikh Mbazi is like this. Oh yes, like that. They come like this. He goes like this. Imagine. He's laughing, isn't it? He can, this will work. Sheikh Al-Albani. So the camera said, you have to turn like this, Sheikh Al-Albani. Turn like that, turn like this. So he's paying attention to what? To the camera rather than to that. Knowledge is given to the people. Allahu al-musta'an. So these people, wallahi, in 1 hour I see them, 640,000 he got. In 1 hour. 640,000. Because he got about 4.something million followers. But he's got as well people just want to see what he's doing. Every week he's got, you know, an episode. Allahu al-musta'an. Allahu al-musta'an. طيب, if you have any questions regarding what we've heard, please. What time is the Maghrib in terms of Adhan wise? 9:15. Very good. We've got 15 minutes for the Adhan, another maybe 5 minutes, 7 minutes after the Adhan. So if you have any questions, please, regarding what we've heard, please go ahead. Fadal.
On the last tashahud.
Last tashahud.
Sometimes the Imam finishes early before you can say the last part. Do you give salam straight away or you delay?
So sometimes the imam finishes quickly the tashahud, and I'm the last tashahud, and the imam is saying salutation. What should I do? Should I do salutation? Cut off the tashahud of mine, the du'a, or should I just keep a bit waiting and then finish it up? Salam alaikum. If what he's left is just few things, no problem. So he said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. He's still reading, isn't it? So he said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. He's still reading. Then after that, he said, Assalamu alaikum. No problem. So you've got the correct thing is to follow him. He said, right? You say with him, right. See, left? You say left. But you want to delay it because of that issue. But don't make it a pattern. So if you know that you're imam, because if it's first time behind the imam, yes. But you have to time your imam. So if your imam is all the time, that's what he does. Then I have to time myself. Some of the imams, even the salaf, even the, you know, sometimes in one of the rak'at, you can't even read the Fatiha unless you read it a bit quick. So if you get used to this, put your pace a bit faster. Nah. Jazakallah. But don't, you say, Salaamu Alaikum, the people gets up and you still mashi tashahud, hayatullah. That's not right. Then you'll be falling into that. Prophet of Allah, he said, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ. Imam was being made to be followed. If he makes takbir, make takbir. So let's say Fatiha. He had said Allahu Akbar for ruku, and you have just the last bit of Fatiha. You could just do it as quickly as possible. Say the last two, three verses, quickly, and then follow him for the ruku. Now, Fadhal Faisal.
Sheikh, during Hajj, if someone has relations with his spouse before the first tahallul, we know his hajj is voided and he has to repeat it. Is it a condition he has to repeat the hajj the next year, or can he do so at any time in the future?
Hopefully you're not planning to do that, are you?
I am not, Sheikh, but this is a general question. I'm not planning to do that.
No, it is, he's as a punishment for him to do this, he has to do it from Qabil. So he's able to do it, next year, he has to do it next year. Can't postpone it. Because he had violated something, he should have finished it. And because of this, we cannot tell him to do it straight away because there's no day of Arafah. Day of Arafah to wait until the following year because it's time. So we have to do it the most or the closest opportunity for that person. Now, Fadal ya Shammam. Or Zuhra.
Assalamu alaikum. Combining salah, if you need to combine salah, how long can the gap be in between the two salahs?
If the combination wants to take place, it's according to the convenience of that person. It doesn't matter whether you're going to combine straight away, dhuhr and asr, or you made dhuhr, and then you said, maybe I'm not going to combine, I will wait until asr, but later on after an hour, I said, I'm going to pray my asr. So the combination, it doesn't mean they have to be together. Combination means you're forwarding one prayer to the earlier time or delaying one prayer to the later time. Dhuhr to Asr or Asr to Dhuhr. Maghrib to Isha, Isha to Maghrib. That is, of course, the combination of the person who's himself praying not behind an imam in the masjid. So if the masjid imam wants to make a combination because of the rain, because of the snow, because of the gusting wind, whatever, so this one has to be, first of all, in the first prayer, not in the second prayer. So you have to do it in the dhuhr time to make asr with it. That's the first condition. So you cannot, for example, say, brothers, dhuhr time, we're not going to pray. We're going to delay it until asr. Why? Because the weather forecast is saying it's going to be raining at that time. No. We have to pray it at the beginning, the first prayer. Secondly, is that it has to be together. You cannot just wait for an hour after people leave and then. But he can, for example, after the dhuhr had finished, he finished it, and he was not planning to do the combination. While the people are still there, mashallah, the weather change and snowing and rain and wind. Okay, we're going to make the asr. No problem about that. But after the people had left, and then the changed weather, then he would, you know, for the prayer to be called back again? No, because it's being made to make it easy for the people. So once the people had left, then call them back again, you didn't make it easy for them. So it has to be, you know, when the people are together. But there is no harm for the person who's making such a combination, is to pray one prayer in one masjid, let's say, and this masjid decided not to make the combination, but he knows there's another masjid which normally he makes combination to leave after the dhuhr to catch up with what? With the asr of that masjid. No problem. Some of the masjid do not really make the combination. Some of them, like for example, Hanafi, they don't make combination at all. Okay? So if you want to go to another masjid makes combination, no problem. It doesn't have to be with that imam. Now, Fadal ya Shammam.
Assalamu alaikum, Shahana.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ahsan Allahu ilayk. Could you briefly explain the history behind Yawm al-Ridda after the Prophet ﷺ died and the role of Abu Bakr during this time? Barakallahu feek.
So we're going to start a new lecture, Ikhwani. This is really not really a suitable time to explain the time of the Ridda and what happened, but we know that the Prophet ﷺ, he had made an army led by Usama, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and Fadha Jaysa Usama. He made the army to leave even though the Prophet ﷺ had died and the Islamic State was not really, was fragile, was not steady. But yet Abu Bakr, despite of all the companions, he said no. Prophet of Allah, he wanted to send it, and he sent it. And Usama was at the outside circuit of the Medina. He did not join into the funeral of the Prophet. Usama, he made them to go and take the army, go ahead. Despite Umar saying, he in the peak of country, we need the army in Medina now at the moment. He said, no. And Allah Azza wa Jal put barak into that. Because once he sent it, the ones who are surrounding, the ones who are waiting for the moment that the Muslim country will go down, look at them. They can afford to send the army. And they are in this moment. That means they must be very strong. So they were scared. So the ones who are trying to, you know, fish in the dirty water, they couldn't do that. Because of the barakah of Abu Bakr implementing the wish of the Prophet of Allah that the army should go there. طيب, حرب الردة إخوانا, as I said, there are some categories of the people. Some of them, the Muslims, had refused to pay the zakah. Some of them, they denounced the zakah, all of it. So they are kuffar. Some of them, they were actually showing Islam because of the strength of the Islam. And once the Prophet ﷺ had died, they showed their reality. And the incident, the conversation took place between Abu Bakr and Umar regarding the issue. There's plenty of things that we talk about here, but I think I leave some for the other brothers who want to ask questions. Any questions? Fadal. Child, no problem to make his Isha early. He doesn't have to pray after Maghrib. Make him think that he's doing the Isha. So after he prays Maghrib, half an hour after that, make him do the Isha. So he thinks he's making the Isha on time. Make him think that, because he's a child. He'll be happy, because if he believes that he made Isha not the right time, be upset maybe. You know what grandma had done to me when I was fasting? Allah, my mother, the mother of my mother. Allahu musta'an. When I used to play as a kid, and it was Ramadan during the summer, it's a bit long. And we were not really, we were poor. People just cook things, you know, and everybody has to get together. So they bake the bread inside Tabun, I remember. So we were praying, And I said to Grandma, I'm hungry. And it was Asr time, I remembered, Asr time. I'm hungry. So I don't know, I can't take it. And she wanted me to finish the day and to eat with this, the rest of the people, with their family. Lots of people, grandma, mother, and everything. Oh, I couldn't. So she gave me something to eat. A little, I remember a little thing, like small, half a tablet, it looks like. I took it. They had to wake me up for Maghrib. I have to wake up for the Maghrib. So I've eaten, thinking I fasted. Do you understand me? Until I grew up and I was talking, wallahi, I was like this, I was talking, alhamdulillah, when I was a kid, even I fasted. Huh? I did not fast. You gave me a tablet. Thinking I was fasting. I wouldn't recommend anybody to give a tablet to the children, no. But I'm just saying, I'm taking as an example that she made me think that I fasted. Years after that. Okay, so she make him think as well that he's prayed the time. On time. So yeah, after half an hour, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, make him pray. Yeah, it's too much for the children to stay until 11 o'clock. Naam, fadl.
Things we can do to be more busy.
Do you want to take the microphone? No. Go on.
Things we can do to be more blessed in our time.
Coming to the classes. Things that can be done to be happy in Allah. Whatever you do to please Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will please you. Is that what you gain happiness, yeah? Yeah. Shama. To gain happiness. Is that to gain happiness, you say?
Blessed,
yeah. The same thing, happiness, blessed. Anything that pleases Allah Azza wa Jal, we get blessings for that. Tayyib Khani. You know that we are coming. This is the last thing I'm going to be reminding you. You've got 3 minutes here before the Adhan. Or shall I wait for the Adhan? I'll wait for the Adhan. And then I'll... Because after the Adhan, I have to say about this when the people come, because then I'll give more reminders. Now,
the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, when he finished rebuilding Masjid al Aqsa, he made dua to Allah on behalf of any person that comes with the intention of praying in that Masjid, he will leave completely free from sin. Is that a specific prayer, like, or is it like any prayer that you pray?
So the Prophet ﷺ, he said about the Prophet Sulaiman, I'll repeat the question for the online. So he said to the Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, said that about Prophet alayhi salam, that when Prophet Sulaiman remaintained, because he did not build it. Who built it? Who built Masjid al-Aqsa? SubhanAllah. What is this? Who built Masjid al-Aqsa, ikhwan? Yaqub, well done. Because between the building of Masjid al-Haram and Masjid al-Aqsa is only 40 years, and it cannot be Sulaiman. Sulaiman is about hundreds of years. Sulaiman is the son of Dawood. Sulaiman alayhi salam, when he re-maintained the building of Masjid al-Aqsa, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala three things, not one, three things. Two has he been given, and one, I wish, inshallah, Allah has given it to him. Which is the one that you just said. That any person makes wudu in his house, come to the Masjid al-Aqsa to pray the two rak'ah, that they will become sinless. A wish, inshallah. Is it specific to rak'ah? No. It's not really a specific salah. You just pray two rak'ah there. So, inshallah. But it is not match for praying in the Masjid al-Haram. It's not a match. Okay? Because the Masjid al-Haram, the prayer in it is 100,000. Where the Masjid al-Aqsa is only one. 250, well done. Because some people say 500. 250, well done. Okay, Ikhwani. Now the Adhan, Ikhwani? الله أكبر الله أكبر
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه إخواني, I just want to remind of an important occasion is coming ahead. Some of the people maybe they don't know about it. When we come to the last 10 nights of Ramadan, mashallah, we find the people coming to the masajid, and that's rightly so, with great numbers. But unfortunately, they don't know that there is ahead of them days, they are better than the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Na'am, there is no comparison. The first 10 days of Hijjah, they are the best, by the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, مَا مِنْ أَيَّامٍ الْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ فِيهَا أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْأَيَّامِ. There is no other days upon which the righteous good deeds are more rewardable, more lovable to Allah than the righteous deeds which are performed in those days, meaning the first 10 days of the Hijjah. They said, Messenger of Allah, even fighting for the sake of Allah, jihad, he said, even making a jihad in Sabilillah, they are better, except for something which is normally doesn't take place, very rare. Person who puts his self and his wealth in danger and returns with neither. So this person is going to be a martyr and also is putting his money into the jihad and he's returning with neither of those two. He's losing his self and his wealth. And this is very rare. Anybody other than that, then righteous deeds in those days better than any righteous deeds. The night of Al-Qadr is a great night, but it's not a match for the day of Eid al-Adha. أَعْظَمُ الْأَيَّامِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمُ النَّحْرِ. The best of days in the sight of Allah. Laylatul Qadr, yes, it's been mentioned in Surah Al-Qadr, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr, was specified by the Quran, revealed. But do you know, as for the first 10 days of Al-Hijjah, they were mentioned, and the last 10 nights of Ramadan is not mentioned in the Quran. Did you know that? Allah Azza wa Jal, when He spoke to Musa alayhi salam, He spoke to him on the day of Arafah. And when Allah says, Wa atmamnaha bi ashr, ashr here is the 10 days of Hijjah. Also to mention, وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, by the dawn and by the 10 nights. Which 10 nights here? Not the last 10 nights of Ramadan. No. By the 10 days of the 10 nights, meaning the first 10 days of Hijjah. The Fajr here is the dawn of Eid al-Adha. Allah makes an oath by Eid al-Adha. And again, he repeats the oath, وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ. And by the even and the odd, the even here is the 10th and the odd is the 9th. Those days, these include Arafah. So Arafah and the preceding days, all of it to prepare you for the best of days of the sight of Allah. From day 1 to day 9, all of it preparation. The peak is day 9. But the preparation for what? For the 10th day, which we call it Yawm al-Hajj al-Akbar. The greatest day of Hajj, which is the pilgrim, he will do all sorts of types of rituals in that day. He will throw the jamarat, he will shave the head, and he will slaughter the animal, and he will do the tawaf, and he will do the sa'i. All of those in the 10th day of the Hajj, Yawm al-Ashr. All your rituals. So this is why we need to make sure that we are prepared in terms of ibadah wise for those days. Let's prepare ourselves, ikhwani. Today, Islamically we're talking about is the 28th, because we just entered the Maghrib, the 28th of Dhul Qa'dah. Tomorrow is 28th night now. Tomorrow is 28th day. The day after the 29th, so you could start this either al-Jumu'ah. So the night preceding the Jumu'ah is the first night of the first of Dhul-Hijjah. Or it could be, because this month it could be 30 days, then it is the night which precedes As-Sabt, Saturday, is the first night. Most likely it's the night precedes al-Jumu'ah. So you got tomorrow, and the day after tomorrow, and during the night, it could be the first night. And that is for the start of the first day of Dhul Hijjah. And if you have a family, or you are a person on your own but independent, and you are having the means financially capable, then you must slaughter an udhiyah. And this udhiyah makes it incumbent upon you not to cut your nails or cut your hair from anywhere, or peel off the skin from that night, which is preceding Al-Jumu'ah, if Al-Jumu'ah is going to be the first day of Dhul-Hijjah, until your Udhiyah is to be slaughtered. And this is only for the person who is in charge of the Udhiyah. So if you are a family, the family head, it's only you to abstain from that, not the rest of the family. So you will abstain from the nails, cutting the nails and cutting the hair from anywhere, and also from peeling off the skin. I would urge you tonight, go cut your nails from now, because you might forget. And when they are growing too much, in 10 days they're going to be itching. So if you are the head of the family and you are having the financial capability, you must make Ikhwani Udhiyah. We've got 2 minutes left for the Iqamah. And in those days, as I said, the day of Arafah. Prophet ﷺ, he said, he who fasts the day of Arafah, and that's for the non-pilgrim. The pilgrim, you should not fast the day of Arafah. He who fasts the day of Arafah, then it will expiate how many years? How many years? 2 years. 1 year before and 1 year after. Now the day of Arafah, if we're going to start the Jumu'ah is the first day, then happens to be As-Sabt is the day of Arafah. Saturday. So if we're going to start the Jumu'ah, the day of Arafah, the 9th, will be the day of As-Sabt. And if it's the day of As-Sabt, it's controversial. Some scholars, they said, you should not fast the day of Arafah if it happens to be on As-Sabt. Some of them, they said, you have to fast the day before or a day after. Okay, some of them, they said, no problem. But the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ regarding that issue, it says لا تصوموا يوم السبت إلا في ما افترض عليكم. Do not fast As-Sabt until it is fard, compulsory upon you. So take the opinion which you believe is correct. I myself, I will not fast if it happens to be As-Sabt, because it's not allowed unless it is obligatory. Also, the day of Arafah is the day upon which Allah will descend down a descendance which is suitable to His Majesty, and He will forgive for all the people. Everybody, the ones on the plain of Arafah, everybody, because He will be boasting about His slaves before His angels. Look at my slaves coming from far and near with uncombed hair, faces covered with dust. Behold, I've forgiven them all, even if the sins is to be as many as the particles of the sand, and as the many of the drops of the rain, as many of the as much as the filth of the sea, I've forgiven them all. This is the day which Allah frees more people than any time. Not even Ramadan is not a match. The day of Arafah. Now, plenty of things to be said about the day of Arafah and the day of Al-Adha, but because of the time now, it's 25, and we need to embark on our prayer. Subhanakallah bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu fiik.